Picture this. It's the year 1986, and the video game industry is thriving all across the world. The former king of the United States market, Atari, was dethroned not too long ago after a bucket load of shovelware contributed to our video game crash. Despite this setback, the pastime's reputation was slowly but steadily recovering thanks to Nintendo's quality assurance policies, ensuring that you get your money's worth out of every game you buy. Gradius was one of the 19 approved games for 1986, selling over 1 million units in Japan alone. Only one of many pieces of evidence that indicated home consoles would be here to stay, despite their hardware having severe limitations compared to their arcade counterparts. People were willing to pay a premium to take the arcade experience home. If your household was able to afford the luxury of owning a computer dedicated solely for the purpose of playing video games, it was as close to the original arcade game as you were going to get for a while. Computer conversions on the big names like Commodore 64 and MSX existed too, but that's outside the scope of this video, and they were only really distributed in Europe and Japan. That's important to consider because that's where the tried and true arcade model steps in. Plopping down hundreds of dollars just for a couple of games was a bit much for some people to swallow, but a mere quarter in exchange for however long you can last in the game was a more palatable transaction. Bringing us to the subject of today's video, it doesn't mean you can play against another player. It refers to the hardware that it ran on. At first glance, you might think converting the NES version to a coin-op format would be absurd, especially since Gradius was already an arcade game, pushing spectacle that wasn't possible on any home system at the time. But the arcade model has some meddlesome caveats that came with the territory. Operators' and landowners' coffers were never bottomless, just like everybody else, and getting the latest and greatest games could be costly, especially if the game was new and untested with the general game-playing public. Thus, the Nintendo Versus system was conceived. By arcadifying existing NES hardware, everyone would benefit in theory. Operators wouldn't have to fork over as much to get new games out onto the floor. Established Nintendo licensees were already familiar with how the NES hardware worked, so they could develop games more efficiently, and gamers would be able to try the same hip games that their richer peers owned on cartridge. Was it worth it? Strap yourselves in. We're blasting off to find out. Gradius is an action-packed interstellar voyage where you are the fearless pilot of the Big Viper. It zooms, it zips and zaps alien buggers trying to shoot up your ride, and it also booms if it so much as scrapes anything dangerous. All good shoot-em-up fundamentals established in its well-known ancestors, like Space Invaders and Galaga. It seems basic enough at first glance, but then you notice this bar advancing through different names on a list every time you pick up an orange capsule. It was at this very moment that almost everybody realized that Gradius was going to be the action game of the decade. Not just another space game to add to the pile. All it took was 10 seconds for it to bewilder an entire generation with innovation. The first and most important advancement of them all. You see, you'd get the occasional game with a temporary power-up here and there. Galaga allowed you to join two ships together for double firepower, but that was largely brainless. There were no drawbacks for going after the double ship, unless you misfired and accidentally destroyed it. Even then, there was no forethought involved. It was all dexterity. Here, you have multiple different weapon configurations that you can switch between mid-level. Both selectable weapon upgrades have their own perks and drawbacks. The double shot lets you get all those pesky ceiling dwellers, but your rate of fire is slower as a consequence. Whereas the laser can only fire straight ahead, but it dishes out double damage to compensate for its shortcoming. It's not just helpful. It's essential to have the right tool for the job going into the later half of the game's seven stages. Konami introduced Intellect, the games that used to be purely reactionary, impressively using player-selectable loadouts to the fullest extent possible in the same game they introduced it in. even when you're not pursuing the necessities, there's room to freestyle with the remainder of the choices. Options enhance your ship's power by giving it a shadow that'll fire alongside you and copy your every move, doubling and then tripling your firepower, or a deployable force field that'll protect you from the top and the front for a certain amount of hits. This lets you figure out what works best for you, whether that be going for the safety of having a shield or hustling for extra firepower first. No other action game had anything like this in 1986. We take things like selectable weaponry for granted nowadays, but this was sheer royalty back in the day. The full arsenal makes you feel like a complete badass as you melt the Bacterian forces into slag with your blazing lasers. But even with all that firepower, it's not a walk in the park. You've got to thrust your way through 7 turbulent stages in distinct, visually memorable locations guarded by armadas of anti-spacecraft artillery. They'll never let you slip through the gaps without a fight, and it's a darn good fight. Shots will be fired, and oftentimes not straight at you. You'll have to be on your guard at all times to react to these projectiles, because they're never going to fly in the same direction twice. Coupled alongside the walkers and the drones are larger stationary targets that won't move from their place or vary their attack patterns, like these bizarre Easter Island heads that only shoot destructible rings in your direction, and won't give you the old dipsy doodle. Radius has a healthy balance of static patterns and randomization. This contrast is established as early as the first stage, where a pair of volcanoes erupt angrily. It looks impossible to dodge at first glance, but there are numerous safe spots that'll get you through the daunting rock shower undefeated. It feels incredible to overcome the first time around, and in subsequent playthroughs, you won't be bored because there aren't permanent safe spots to protect you leading up to the harrowing set piece. I feel as though this balance is the winning formula for timeless shoot-em-ups. An element of skill is still required so you can't autopilot your way through the entire game every single time, like R-Type or Image Fight, but it won't drive away lesser skilled players as quickly as something like Toho 6 would, which demands your undivided attention, because nothing's set in stone. Both of those approaches have their own appeal, but having the best of both worlds pleased a lot of people. Alright, we covered the gist of the action and paid our respects where they are due, but there's one major elephant in the room that likely turned away a lot of newcomers. Checkpoints. If you die, you lose everything and become a minnow scrambling for survival in the shark tank. This was Konami's way of preventing the relatively modest difficulty from ever being too easy. A stark reminder that Gradius is still an arcade game that has to make its money back somehow, because everything becomes a hell of a lot harder when you're stuck with your measly pea shooter. You're encouraged to try to get through as much of the trip as possible on your first life, but mistakes can happen to even the best of players, and that can be infuriating. It might seem impossible to recover at first glance, but since this game isn't nearly as harsh as later games in the series would be, it's entirely possible to get out of your grave with excellent reflexes and enough determination. It feels tremendously satisfying to avert your own game over if you manage to do it, yet I would imagine most players' patience would wear thin after numerous continues and failed attempts, which is why the entire system was challenged by later games in the shmup genre. I'm willing to give it a pass this time around, though, on the basis that this is an early game and the designers still hadn't figured out better ways to do difficulty yet. Some of the later games in the series are significantly harder because they're made for people that were already Gradius fans, making the checkpoint recoveries in those unnecessarily cruel and stupid. Those death-defying checkpoint recoveries are an apt metaphor for the entire game. You are David going up against Goliath. Goliath isn't invincible, and if you still need assistance, there are numerous secrets scattered throughout the game waiting to be discovered. You might find yourself with extra lives or putting yourself in peril on purpose, auto-fire to give your hand a much-needed rest, or even warps that'll skip you across entire levels if you can find them. With enough time and a handful of quarters to memorize those devious traps barricading the road to victory, you'll break into the Bacterian base, leaving nothing but piles of ashes behind you as you face the enemy's fearless leader, a defenseless brain masterminding interplanetary conquest. Press the fire button a few times, give it a little payback, and get out of Dodge as their base goes boom! The people of Gradius can rejoice as you head home, a job well done. Your reward for all your efforts is congratulatory text and an extra life as you are whisked back to the beginning to do it all again at a higher difficulty level. Bewildering as it may be to anybody that's played anything newer, proper closure and endings in games that weren't about racing to the finish line were exceedingly rare to see in the mid-80s. The older generation of gamers that grew up on these games were still accustomed to Atari, where oftentimes there'd be no endings at all. Any game with an ending back then knew the direction the video games were heading, since this is an early form of structure and narrative, even though I've seen them as the standard for 3 decades now. You could say that Versus Gradius and its fancier counterpart, Regular Gradius, were transitional games that still clung on to some of the design philosophies established by their grandfathers, but rolled out the red carpet for the next generation, for everything fresh and new it managed to accomplish. Heck, go figure how I was able to get this much out of an older shoot-em-up. The fine folks at Hamster, who went out of their way to approach Nintendo with the opportunity to resurrect this classic from the ages, got this game up on the Nintendo Switch eShop for $8, American. At that price, it's a steal if you're a fan of die-hard action games, or you're looking for a decent challenge. Save states were included in this version to help you practice those difficult segments. But once you've gotten the hang of them, I'd highly recommend trying to get as far as possible without any assistance, so you can feel the thrill and the tension that you would have felt if you were playing the game when it were brand new. It's not the same if there isn't any pressure involved. That'll do it for me this time around. I look forward to talking more about shoot-em-ups in the future, and I'm especially excited to continue my investigation into the Nintendo Versus system. One game isn't enough to draw any conclusions for Nintendo's experimental idea. See you next time, folks!